How many enjoyed that Jimmy Evans marriage video last week? Wasn't that awesome? That was so good that we had to get it to you guys. But we have had some negative stuff as a result of that because, you know, Jimmy Evans kept stressing how everyone is messed up. He kept stressing that. So most we've had positive feedback, but we have had some negative. This is from Michael Peterson, and it hasn't been good for Michael. He said his wife Leslie is a wreck. This comes from him. He says, "I'm trying to settle her down. She spent the last 20 plus years thinking I was the best thing going. Now after the preaching this morning, she thinks that maybe I could have some problems." Leslie, we've been trying to tell you. "It's just too much for her to take. I hope I can get her reeled back in soon." And then I text him back. I said, "Sorry to blow your cover. You had a good thing going." Funny stuff, right? All right, I guess the children are released and we'll get into the message. Praise God. I'm going to get here and... How's everyone doing? Good? Awesome. This message, if you have a flyer, they're not bulletins. Think about it. Bulletin, they're not. No. Okay. All right. Some of you will get that later on. Well, that's funny. No. All right. But inside there's a thing we put together called How to Abide in the Vine. That's the title of today's message, How to Abide in the Vine. And it's just got four simple points on the back. It has John 15, the first eight verses of John 15 in the Amplified Bible, I believe it is. And it's just got four points, and I'm going to elaborate on these points. First of all, I want to talk to you how important it is to abide, what abiding is. Amen? What does it mean to abide? This is why people don't bring forth fruit in their Christian walk that are truly born again. You need to be born again. But if you don't abide in the vine, you won't bring forth fruit. Can I have from the King James, Proverbs 11, 28, I think? We'll find out. Proverbs 11, 28. Yes, he that trusteth in his riches shall fall. Now that's not just, we think of riches, we only think of material riches, etc. But that's in any area. You know, if we trust in our own ability. Amen? If I trust in my athleticism. Yeah, it's really bad news. No, I'm kidding. He that shall fall, but watch this. But the righteous shall flourish. How shall the righteous flourish? As a branch, not as a trunk. Not as a vine, not as the power generator, but as a branch. The righteous, those people that are born again, we flourish as a branch. That's big. Now go to John chapter 15 and verse 1. We're going to start there. And it's on your inside, it's on the front actually. And then I want to talk about this because this is huge. Jesus says, this is Jesus speaking. He said, "I am the true vine. And my Father is the husbandman or the vine dresser." So once again, the righteous flourish as a branch. Not as the trunk, not as the vine, but we flourish as a branch. The flip side of that is if I try to be the vine, the generator or the source, I don't flourish. Amen. See, that's what religion, man's religion, I'm not talking about the pure religion James talks about, but I'm talking about man's religion teaches us, puts us in the wrong position, right? Where we're generating it. That's why, let me say this to you. The Bible says in 1 John 4:19 that we love God, or we love, period. God's not in the Greek, but we love, period. You could say God. It's not incorrect. It's just incomplete. We love, period, because he first loved us. We actively love. See, man's religion teaches you that you love God without a revelation that he loves you. Mm-hmm. That's right. Did you hear what I'm saying? Yeah. Like man has some resources of his own. We're totally bankrupt without him. Amen. And we got to continue that revelation. I was sitting there thinking today, you know, one of the things I take authority over in my life and I'm trying to get more regular with it is I curse self-righteousness in my life. I don't want to be self-righteous. I want to consistently be depending upon his righteousness. The Bible says, "I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness." Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And that seek is a present, continuous, ongoing action. You know, that's what it is. And it says, you know, I will boast of his strength. That's a consistent theme. Even that's one of the book of Psalms, I believe, has so much new covenant implication because it looks forward to where you and I are at. But it's all about what he did. So once again, so we need to abide in that. Now watch this. Leave this verse up here for because we're going to talk about it. Every branch in me, you could say every believer that's truly born again. Jesus speaking says, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. One translation says he cuts it off. How many know that's not true? God's not going to cut you off. Hallelujah. Amen. But we'll get to this in a minute. And every branch that bears fruit, he purgeth it. Oh, man. Purgeth it. What does that mean? That it may bring forth more fruit. How many know God's interested in fruit? Now, what is fruit? I'll show you. Let me just one thing at a time. So every branch in me that bears not fruit, number one, he takes away. I'm going to talk to you about this a little bit. Every branch, every believer that's in Christ in me, watch this, that beareth, hold on, I'll get it here. Every branch in me, because I want to give you the Greek, that beareth fruit, or that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. The word taketh away, you remember what? We talked about this a long time ago. Remember this word? Aero, like A-I-R-O is the Greek word. Watch what it means. It does not mean to cut off. It does not mean he's going to kick you out. Right. Isn't that good news? It's aero, and it means, and by the way, this is present tense. He keeps doing this. But you got to cooperate. See, our part, let me say this. Say it, my part is to cooperate. Now watch this. So here's what it means. He taketh away. It means to raise up. It means to elevate. It means to lift up. It means to raise from the ground. It means to raise upwards. It means to elevate. It means to lift up. You get the idea. God's not cutting people off. He's trying to lift you up. And he's saying, if you're not bearing fruit, it's because you got a low concept of God, because you're approaching God through you instead of through his son. Right. You know, God wants you to take the limits off him. Yes. And so what does he do? He lifts you up. You know, the greatest way to stay in a struggle is to receive condemnation. If you don't understand, if you think God's cutting you off because you're not bearing fruit, you'll stay in that struggle. Guaranteed. But if you see God, see what we're trying to do today is lift you up. This ain't about your performance. It's about Jesus and what he did. Amen. Amen? Amen. That's good news. Now watch this. He's consistently doing this. And every branch that, oh, this is so good. Oh, this is so good. Watch this, watch this, watch this. Come on, phone. If not, I'll just tell you what it says. What are these phones? Is everybody on their phone? Is that what it is? That's what it is, isn't it? If not, we're just going to do it. But every branch in me that bears fruit, he purges it. Why? That it may bring forth more fruit. Once again, this is a continuous action. The word purge means he washes it. How we're washed by the washing of the water by the word. Watch this. One definition, he washes from guilt. Isn't that good news? So if you're bearing fruit, he's continually washing you from guilt. You know where guilt comes from? Looking at you. See, we're talking about abiding in the vine. You can't, if you don't understand the role of the vine and your role, you're not going to abide in the vine. Amen? Amen. Now, leave this verse up here. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he takes away, or he elevates, he lifts it up. And every branch that is bearing fruit, he's washing it, he's cleansing it. That's what the word means. He's cleansing it from guilt. Watch this, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now, what is fruit? Here's what we think fruit is. We think, okay, fruit is me being nice, right? Well, it's good to be nice, all right? But the fruit he's talking about is specific. Everybody say specific. I'm going to show it to you and we'll come right back here. Jump to verse, the same chapter, jump to verse 7. No, verse 8. Herein is my Father glorified. There it is again. Leave it up there. That you, here's the, so watch this. The Father's glorified. How? Watch this. That ye bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. God's glorified when you bear much fruit. Amen? Would you agree with that? So what is much fruit? Back up one verse. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. The fruit he's talking about is answered prayers. How many know God's good? We know God's good. See, we think this fruit is, we don't even know. We say these things, but many times we don't even know what they are. God's glorified when prayers are answered. He's not glorified when they're not. Who wants to glorify God? I do. But I have to abide in him. Now, what does that mean? See, reading this stuff and not getting it in your heart and understanding what it means, we miss it. Knowledge is easy if you understand. Knowledge is hard if you don't. In fact, the Bible says in Matthew 13:19, anyone who hears the word of the kingdom and understands it not, Satan's able to steal that which was sown in his heart. That's pretty strong. So this is awesome. I want to glorify God, but it comes by abiding in him. Now back up to verse 3, and then we'll take a running start at the verse. Back up. I just want to read 3, and then we'll go into every branch in me that bears not fruit, he lifts it up. He elevates it. You know, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, that we've been raised up and seated together with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's where he's lifting you up to your position in Christ so he can see who you are. You know, problems look small when you're up high. Everything looks small when you're up high. Now watch this. It says, every branch in me bears not fruit. He lifts it up, and every branch that's bearing fruit, he washes it, cleanses it from guilt so it can bring forth more fruit. You know what stops us is guilt. We limit God because we look at us instead of him. How many know he's unlimited? You know, I've only asked God to touch the world. That's not too big. It's God. He's God, right? I understand this treasure's in an earthen vessel. It ain't about the vessel. It's about what's in the vessel. You know, that's humility, and that's humbling myself under God's hand. Oh, God, I can't say that. They're going to think you think you're something. No, I think he's everything. That's called faith. Look at the next verse. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Now this is talking about position. Position. This word right here for word is logos. Logos is the eternally written word. Jesus is the logos in John 1:1 and John 1:14, right? So you're clean through the word. That's our position, right? But we read it in John 15, verse 7. Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you'll ask what you want and it'll be done unto you. The Greek word for words is rhema. What's rhema? Anybody remember? A fresh application of the eternally written word. When Jesus said in Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every rhema that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's the fresh application on a consistent basis of God's eternally written word. It's called relationship. Amen. All right. Now you are clean. Position. Next verse. Abide in me. Now what does it mean to abide? We're going to talk about this. Abide means to stay put, to reside, not to visit. Amen. If you have a branch in a tree and you constantly cut that branch off and then you try to put it back in and you cut it off, it's not going to bring forth fruit. I'm telling you guys, this is where people miss it. That's why I tell people, burn the bridges. You can't lose unless you quit. I'm not losing. And sometimes I'm tempted to think I am. But God said it, not me. I'm going to glory in him. I'm going to say yes to him and burn the bridges. Well, I don't feel like it. Tell your feelings to shut up and do what God says. That's abiding in what he's told you. That's the fresh application of the eternally written word. I don't always feel like being married, but I am. Right. So we live by feelings. This is a touchy-feely side. Oh, I fell in love. I fell out of love. I fell in love. Ah, don't you want to slap him? Oh. That's not love.
No, it isn't.
The Lord showed me something. I did a Facebook post on it, what the difference between lust and love was. I never saw this. I think it's in Genesis 29:20 or somewhere around there. And I never, ever saw this until the Lord quickened it. But let me see if that's where it's at. I'll show it to you. We'll come back to John 15:4. I think it's Genesis 29:20. I could be wrong. But Jacob, when he served for Rachel, watch this. I was just reading this, minding my own business, praying in the spirit like I do when I read under my breath. And Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed unto him but a few days for he the love he had to her. This just jumped at me. He said, the Lord said, this is the difference between love and lust. Lust would not wait 7 years. Remember Tamar and Amnon? Now. I got to have it now. That's lust. That's lust. This is love. And I saw that. I thought, oh, Lord, you are good. God talks to you people, and he'll talk right out of his word. And I was like, I never knew that till I read that. Simple, but powerful. Amen. We need to know the difference. John 15:4. John chapter 15 and verse 4. I can't help but be excited. This stuff's so good. God's word is so amazing. But see, if you abide in him, listen to me. If you abide in him, you can't lose. God's gonna have his plan through your life. And that's what I want. I would rather park cars and be in the perfect will of God than to have a worldwide ministry and be my thing and calling it God. My, you know what success is? Being in God's perfect will. And guess what? If you're thankful right now for what you have right where you're at, you're in God's perfect will. Just keep staying there. Keep thanking him for what you have, and you won't quench the spirit, and he'll be able to give you more. You know how the miracle of the loaves and the fishes, you know how it increased? Jesus thanked the Father for what he had, and he broke and distributed, and God multiplied it. When you're thankful for what you have, you release God to multiply what you already have. But the church is waiting till they hit some certain level in the exterior, and I'm going to be this, and I'm going to be that, and then I'm going to be happy. Then I'm going to be thankful. I can promise you it'll be something else then, because it'll never be enough. The eyes of man are never satisfied. Oh, my word. If the church would abide in his thankfulness and thanking God for what they have, God would be able to give them more. And they would be able to distribute and bless more people. You know, if this is all I ever do, if this is it, if this is the epitome of my success, it's way more than I ever deserved in myself in the first place, and I'm extremely thankful. Come on. Satan is a master at making us look at what we don't have. That's how mankind fell. All the trees in the garden, he got them to look at the one thing God said no. And the only reason he said no is because man had to have a will. That's how he works today too. Think about it. They were in a perfect world. Perfect people in a perfect world. You think the enemy could get through to imperfect people in an imperfect world? Absolutely. You cannot bring forth fruit if you uproot and replant and uproot and replant. You got to stay planted, and you got to tell your flesh to shut its mouth, and you got to stop expecting everything out here to be perfect and let God work on your heart and rejoice for what you have. Amen. You know how blessed we are to have a new covenant church? I'm around. I'm telling you, there's places they don't have them. I mean, I hear people that, oh man, and this and that and all the other thing. What a blessing. Thank God for it. The Lord showed me something one time. A major key to happiness is learning to be thankful for what you have while you have it. You want to know the key to a good marriage? You start thanking God for your husband or wife. You start praising God for your husband and wife.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Wait a minute. Hold on. You know what this is? This is when I call for an instant replay. When I watch football with Rich, I'll pull this out. You know, when they want to have an, I'll throw it. Nobody listens to me though. Abide in me. Abide in me, Jesus is saying. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except you abide in me. Do you know so many people do their own thing and ask God to bless it rather than finding out God's thing and knowing it's already blessed?
Right.
Can anybody hear the difference?
Amen. Amen.
See, that's the problem. Lord, I'm going to do this, now you bless it. No, what are you doing, Lord? And let me find that, and that's already blessed. Find the wave that's coming in and ride that wave instead of creating your own. Next verse. I got to say something else. Back up to verse 4. I just want to say something quick about that verse. Look at this, the end of it. No more can ye... As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, Jesus is the vine, no more can you, or ye, except you abide in me. You know what? I see this a lot in the body of Christ. People are substituting works, and they're trying to identify with what they're doing instead of with what Jesus did. You've got to learn, and see, this is where, are you saying good? We're ordained to good works, Ephesians 2:10. But listen, if you get good works before you understand God's work, you're going to be making your works an idol. Can anybody hear that? That's what people do. Well, what am I called to do? What am I called to do? Don't worry about what you're called to do. Let me tell you what you're called to do. Give thanks with what you have right where you're at.
All right.
Listen, it'll happen.
Yes.
I'm talking to me as much as you. God's doing things. But my part is to abide. How do you do that? We're getting there. All right, next verse. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Next verse. If a man abide, this is amazing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and God sends him to hell. That ain't what it says. If a man doesn't abide in me, he's cast forth as a branch, just like a branch is. He's talking about in the eyes of people, not in the eyes of God. Are you hearing me? How many people have I seen, if you've been saved more than 2 weeks, you've probably seen it too, or more than a couple years at least. How many people have I seen start stuff and never finish? You know God tests us. Now, I'm not talking about temptations, testing, and trials. I'm not talking about let no man say when he's tempted, he's tested or tried. But there are tests in the kingdom of God. God, we got quiet. The Bible says in Psalm 105, verse 19, talking about Joseph of Genesis, until his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. You know what Joseph was? He was a faithful man.
Amen.
He kept going, and God prospered him in every situation he was in. If we would constantly be about that, listen, God is not going to promote us when we're not ready. I'm not letting my son or my daughter drive a semi when they're riding tricycles.
Amen.
Why? Because I love them too much. It's not about your call, it's about Jesus.
That's right. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Your call, God, listen, God loves you so much. Don't worry about that. If a man abide not in him, he's cast forth as a branch is withered. Men gather them, not God, and cast them into the fire of their judgment. Not God's. Now we did verses 7 and 8, jump to verse 9. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue, meno, the Greek word, or abide in my love for you.
Right.
You see that? As the Father hath loved me, Jesus speaking, as the Father hath loved me, Jesus, so have I loved you. Continue in this love. You know what that means? I can get away from that, even though it's in me. See, Barry Bennett had a wonderful post this morning. He was talking about what we talked about a couple weeks ago. Vertical and horizontal. You know, vertically, God loves us, but we need to exhibit things horizontally. Amen? You understand that? Can you see the cross? That's what you might want. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Next verse. God, I could camp on this one. If you keep my commandments, there we are, back under the law. No, you're not back under the law. The commandments he's talking about here, there's one twofold New Testament commandment. Did you know that? One, but it's twofold. All right? If you keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Now I'm going to show it to you. Jump back to, we'll come back here. Jump to 1 John chapter 3, verse 19. And we'll come right back to John 15, 10. And hereby we know that we are, back to verse 18. There's a reason. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. In other words, I love you, but it's just words, right? But then there's love that has an action behind it. That's what he's saying here. Why is he saying that? Why is he saying that? You know, God is so in love with you, but he says these things for you. Now watch it. He said, my little children, let us not love in just words or in just our with what we're saying, but our actions in deed and in truth. Why? Next verse. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, leave this up here, and shall assure our hearts before him. You know why you love, not just in word, but with your actions? Because you're assuring your heart. You understand that? If you know your heart can be confused? This is why when we talk about speaking God's word, and people say, well, I spoke that, but then I speak contrary to that the rest of the day. You're confusing your heart. Do you know if I live contrary, if I live in sin as a Christian, you know God still loves me? Did you know that? But you know I'm confusing my heart? You understand that? God won't throw me out, praise God. But you know, if I consistently rebel at the Word of God and do my own thing, I'm confusing my heart. And you know, your heart's where you receive the promises of God. Mm-hmm. See, we need to assure our hearts that what we say we believe, we actually believe. All right, next verse. For if our heart condemns us, he's trying to get you to, giving you some good news here. If your heart's condemning you, watch this. God is greater than your heart. He knows all things. Good news, right? But there's a fight going on because your heart's condemning you. That's what he's talking about. Next verse. Beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence toward God. This is why you got to keep hearing and hearing and hearing. I had one guy tell me one time when we were talking about the feast days in the Old Testament and how they pointed to Jesus and all that. He said, that's great for preachers and pastors and those kind of people. But for normal people like us, it's not. I go, I'm trying to find a nice word for fool. Can't find one. That's foolish. How's that? That's foolish. Because the more you see Jesus, your heart's changing. My heart is getting more and more assured all the time. I'm finding when I pray for people, the power of God goes. I know it. I can feel it. Is it perfect? No. I still deal with doubts come at me. But I'm thinking, man, when I release it, I don't have to figure out if they receive or not. I just release it. My heart is getting more assured because I'm believing in him. I'm looking at Jesus. I'm looking at what he did. You understand? That's why the message is so important. There's a lot of unbelieving believers out there. You know that? They're believers in the sense that they're born again, but they don't believe much of anything. But that doesn't have to be us or you or in. It's our choice. Now, so beloved, if our heart doesn't condemn us, then, somebody say then. Then have we confidence toward God. Next verse. And, whoa, I love this. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. We're talking about his commandments, remember? Because we keep his commandments, all 613 of the old covenant commandments, right, wrong. It's not what is his commandments? He'll tell you right here. Everybody say one. Twofold commandment. Now here it is. Watch it. Whatsoever we ask, our hearts not condemn us, we receive of him. Why? We're keeping his commandments. And we're doing those things. Do. We're producing those things, not in our own strength. We're walking in the light as he is in the light. We do those things that are pleasing in his sight. What pleases God? Faith, right? We're doing those things that are pleasing in his sight. This isn't earning anything. This is receiving what's been earned. Next verse. And here it is. And this is his commandment. Here it is. Now there he says commandment, singular. Everybody say singular. This is his commandment that we believe on, we believe upon, we believe into the name of his son, Jesus Christ. And love one another as he gave us commandment. Yes. Wait a minute, is it commandments or commandments? It's both. One, twofold commandment. Now look at the next verse, and we'll come back here. He that keepeth his commandments, it's because he's dwelling in him, Jesus. And Jesus is dwelling in him. And hereby, watch this, we know that he abides, there's that word, resides in us. Here's how we know, by the Spirit which he has given us. We know there's a knowing on the inside. And you know, the more you know on the inside, the more you'll be able to sense external things. Amen? But notice the command. This is what I want you to see. Back up to verse 23. There he says commandments. Here he says commandment. See that? This is his commandment, singular, that we believe, that we put our faith in Jesus and not in us. You see that? That we believe on the name of his son, Jesus Christ, and love one another. Now what? That's that works, Chris. No. Jesus said in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, he said, a new commandment I give you, not an additional commandment. The church says an additional commandment many times, but he says it's a new commandment. That you love one another as I have loved you. Why is it so important to love one another? Because if you don't, you're walking in darkness. Everybody say walking. Not your position, but your walk. Your walk. Read 1 John 2, verse 6 on down. He says, if you despise your brethren, if you pull them away, you know, hey, I love you, I just ain't going to be around you. That's a form of hate. The Bible says you're walking in darkness and you don't even know what you're going to stumbling over. Anybody ever done that? When you walk in darkness, I'm learning to be very, very careful when it's dark. I move like this. You ever step on a toy or something in the dark? Praise God, glory to God, thank you, Jesus. Now, don't tell me what you say. Now, back to John 15, 10. What are we looking at, Christian? 5 minutes. Okay, great. John chapter 15, verse 10. So this is his commandment. If we keep, guard those commandments that we have, what are they? One, twofold commandment. There's there, it says commandments. It says if we guard those commandments, which is believe on Jesus, right? Right? And say, I believe in Jesus. No, I mean believe on what he did. What he did. You notice when Paul said, I have determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified in 1 Corinthians 2:2. You know why it doesn't say, for I have determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ? Why does he have to throw in and crucified? You ever wonder that? You know why? There's a lot of people believe in Jesus as far as a good person and all that kind of stuff, but it's believing on what he did, his death, burial, and resurrection. That's what Paul, you know what another Jesus is? I go into this sometime out of 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4. Paul talked about another Jesus, a counterfeit Jesus. You know what it is? A crossless Christ. It talks about Jesus, but it doesn't talk about what he did. That's why Paul said that. I have determined not to know anything. Now he's talking about how I'm relating. I'm going to relate through Jesus and what he did. But guys, you don't realize how much of a fight that is. You know, the only time we don't receive from God is we're coming at him probably, in almost every case, we're coming at him some other way outside of Jesus. We're trying to climb up some other way and we don't even know it. This is life and death. I wish people would get that. That's what I pray for the body of Christ. Get an urgency. You stay in faith. You keep looking at Jesus. You keep your eyes on that brazen serpent upon a pole, which was a type and a figure of what Jesus did on the cross when he who knew no sin became sin. Some people are teaching, no, he didn't. Oh, yes, he did. There's a whole teaching going around now that God never forsook Jesus. Yes, he did. So he'll never forsake you. Man, that's good news. If we keep his commandments, ye shall abide in his love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love, or commandments and abide in his love. Next verse, one more. These things have I written unto you that my joy might remain in you and that your joy might be full. God wants you to be full of joy. Amen? But it's contingent upon abiding in him. Okay, quick. Going to do this quick. How do you abide in him? Number one, there's 4 points here, real simple. First of all, the word abide, it's at the very end, means to remain, abide. It means in reference to place. It means not to depart. It means to continue to be present. There, it's all in your outline. It means not to become another or different. Number one, we abide in the written word. What do you mean abide in the written word? Well, when God directs me, I'll give you an example. Say I want friends. Say, Lord, I've been praying for friends. I just can't seem to find friends. Well, let me show you a verse. This is abiding in the written word. God will give you a verse. Look at it. Proverbs 18, 24. Watch this. Number one, you abide in the written word. Watch this. A man that has friends... But Lord, I just can't seem to have, I don't have any friends. What's up? And one day I'm reading my Bible. I'm reading Proverbs, 31 of them, 31 days in most months. Proverbs are actions. But Lord, why aren't you giving me friends? And I read that. A man that has friends must show himself friendly, and there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And all of a sudden the Lord says, wait a minute, you want friends? You need to show yourself friendly. If people come up to me every time and say, hey, how you doing? I don't understand why people don't come around me. You have to ask yourself, is that showing myself friendly? Yes or no? Here's another one. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 6. Watch this one. What did I say, Proverbs? I meant Philippians. That's good though too. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. It says, be careful or anxious for nothing. Do you know anxiety is a choice? We're all tempted with it, but you know it's a choice. See, that makes some people, no, it's not. I can't help it. You can't help it from coming at you, but you can reject it. But watch this. Now I read that one. It says, be careful or anxious for nothing. The Greek says, stop perpetually worrying about even one thing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Now, you get up and you're worried about something. Write it down. You're getting your prayer list. You see that? Well, if you're worried about it, write it down and bring it to God. And it says, if you will choose to reject anxiety and not, God, I love this about God. He never says, don't do this. He always says what to do in place of that. He never just leaves a void. Never. Never. But he says, don't perpetually worry about even one thing, but in everything by this prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And look at the next verse. And the peace of God, which passes understanding, shall guard like an army your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. If you got something on your heart, put it down. Find a promise. Proclaim that promise. Cast it on the Lord. And he's promised that his peace will guard your heart and mind like an army, the Greek says. Well, now that's not true. No, you're wrong. God's right. Seriously, you're wrong. God's right. It's good news. You know what I've learned about something? Sometimes people don't want help.
That's right.
Many times they do. They don't know how to get it. I'm not saying that. But there's sometimes, that's why you got to locate. Do people want help? Well, then there's promises for every situation you'll ever face. So number one, we abide in the written word. If God says it, that settles it, whether I believe it or not. But you can be in the written word and miss the living word. You can miss Jesus. John chapter 5, verse 39. What are we looking at, Christian? Fourth down. All right. John chapter 5. I'm going to wrap up. We'll have to finish this next week. But John chapter 5, verse 39. Notice what Jesus said. Search the scriptures. For in them, the scriptures, you think that you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. Once again, this is where I missed it for years. Anybody else miss it here? I did not realize that the gospel was good news because it testified of Jesus. In fact, let me show you this one. I was coming out to church this morning, and this just was, God was talking to me about this. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, verse 3. We're going to get a running start. Watch this. This is an example of how you abide in the living word. The written word, the scriptures point to the living word, Jesus. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. Next verse. But it is a war. For our weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, they're not sensual, they're not of the senses. But they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Next verse. Casting down imaginations. Imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, against what the Word of God says. It'll exalt itself and say, you're going under. I know God says you're going over, but you're going under. That's what it's doing. It's trying to get you in fear. I was thinking of that song they were singing. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Fear is so cruel. And the Bible says, perfect love casts out fear, 1 John 4:18. Because fear is torment. He that fears is not made perfect or complete or mature in love. And you know that word torment? It's found one other place in the entire New Testament. 1 John 4:18, which we just talked about, and Matthew chapter 25, verse 46, when the Lord separates the sheep and the goat and says, these shall go away into everlasting punishment. There it's used for hell. How many know fear can be hell? It is hell. It's torture. That's how cruel fear is. But so we cast down every imagination, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. We bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, not the obedience of me. See, religion wants me to bring every thought in captivity to your obedience. It's not your obedience. It's his obedience, which was perfect.
Amen.
And I was thinking about that. You know, we've preached on it. We've talked about it. But it just jumped at me. I thought, oh, my word. Am I bringing every thought in captivity to his obedience? Or am I still struggling in my obedience? Many times it's me. I'm just going to be honest with you. But man, I'm telling you what, I get the more I see it, that Jesus' perfect obedience is mine, the more I see that, the more confident I get. You know, confidence honors God. Being confident, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, He began the good work in you, He'll continue it until the day of Jesus Christ. He began it, but you got to stay with it. You got to stay keeping your faith in Jesus and not reverting to you. This is why religion is so dangerous. This is why I won't get around stuff that's the wrong spirit. I was talking earlier and I was saying, I went into a store the other day, me and Joel. We went into a video store and just a regular video. We'll check out, see what they have. I stood in there for a few minutes and I could feel it. I said, this is the wrong spirit. I'm out of here. One more? Got time for one more? One more. All right. What time the Packers come on? Or the Cowboys? Or whoever you want. All right. Jump over to, I'm going to do this one quick. John, this is part of obedience. Number one, we abide in the written word. We abide in the living word, which is about Jesus. And there's two others. We won't be able to get to that for right now. But jump over to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. Because this is a big point of confusion here. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, don't you love how the Lord talks through the Apostle Paul? Having these promises, say, do we have them or are we trying to get them? We have them right now. Dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. And people get confused about this, and I've heard a lot of different teaching. In fact, I wrote down some stuff here. How many of you know that sometimes it's not what people say, it's the spirit behind how they say things?
That's right.
Amen? That's what this is talking about in this context. You know, can I say something about Hebrew Old Testament and Greek New Testament words? You still cannot violate the context. You cannot violate the context. For example, Galatians 3:3. Look at this one. We'll come back here. I've talked about this one, but you need to see it. Are you so foolish, having begun in the spirit, are you now made perfect in the flesh? See that word flesh? It's the Greek word sarx. Now jump over to Colossians chapter 2, verse 5. Watch this one. And though Paul speaking, though I be absent in the flesh, sarx. In Galatians 3:3, he's talking about performance. Are you now made perfect in the flesh, your own personal human effort or performance? Here he's talking about bodily presence. He says, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, I'm joying and beholding your order. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. And the steadfastness of your faith in your performance. Your faith in Christ. Paul said, though I'm not with you in bodily presence, I'm with you in the spirit. Does that mean Paul was a disembodied spirit floating around outside the congregation? No. He said, my spirit is with you. I'm with you in heart. I'm with you in spirit. In this context, in Galatians 3:3, he was talking about personal performance. Now back to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. And that's what he's saying here, and I don't have time to get into all of it. I got plenty of examples, but I just want to show you. Having the promises, dearly beloved, cleanse yourself from all the filthiness of the flesh or the outward connection and the very spirit behind what people are bringing forth. This is why it's so dangerous to subject yourself to legalistic, contrary teachings, because there's a spirit behind what people say. That's why 1 John chapter 4 says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits. Just because somebody says something, what's the heart behind what they're saying? They may be saying it's about Jesus, but it may be all about you.
That's right.
Why you got to test the spirits. That's why you have discernment. You know what I love about Andrew Womack Ministries? Perfection? No. A right spirit. That's what I love. Oh, the teaching's great. I love all that. Not perfect. It's not. Everything I say isn't perfect. Well, yeah, it is. Just kidding. That's a joke. But I'm saying there's a right spirit. But see, if you override that, that's what he's saying. You're not going to perfect holiness, which is separation, which includes healing, by the way.
Amen.
Did you know holiness, healing is holy?
Healing is holy.
Did you know that? It's the children's bread. Do you know why? Because we're in a broken world. That's why taking communion regularly, not just as a ritual, but reminding myself, this is about what Jesus has done. Listen, this is a fight, guys. It's a fight because of our heart. It's not assured that it is about Jesus. But see, if I consistently hang with people, like for example, I'm a married man, but if I hang out with people that are constantly running down marriage, even Christians, I've seen this happen in Christian circles, guess what? That spirit will get on me. And then I'll start being like them. And then I'll start running down marriage. And then I'll start finding out what's wrong with my spouse. All that kind of stuff will happen. Why? Because I say, I'm going to separate myself from those people outwardly, but I got to separate from the spirit behind. I know this. My wife and I, we got involved with some people that were saying they were grace people. And I'm telling you, you talk about a spirit behind what they were saying. And it's taken us a long time to wash that garbage off. Because they said a lot of good things. A lot of good things. But see, I want to perfect holiness in the fear and reverence of the Lord. I want to in every single area. And I could show you the context. If you back up into, we won't do it, but in chapter 6, he's talking about being who you're yoked with. You can separate on the outside and still be connected at heart. You can be separated from an ex-spouse and be remarried and still be connected to that person at the heart. How many know that's not good for a marriage?
That's right.
You know? Amen?
Amen.
And see, and this is what he's saying. I know I grew up in a particular church, and man, I'm telling you what, it takes a long time to get that stuff. I mean, it runs deep. But see, more and more I go, I'm cleansing myself from the filthiness of the flesh and spirit. Why? Because I want to perfect or allow holiness to mature in every area of my life. Amen? Amen. Quickly, over your outline and we're done. I know it's later than it's ever been. It's number one, the key to abiding in Jesus is abide in the written word. Number two, abide in the living word. Understand that the written word is about the living word, Jesus. Number three, abide in a teachable spirit. Let me say this. Being teachable is not being gullible.
Amen.
One more time. Being teachable is not being gullible. The Bible says we're not to be children tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. That's Ephesians 4:14. So that I could camp on that, moving right along. And the next one is abide in communion with the Holy Spirit. You cannot understand the gospel without the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. So what is the key? Abide in the vine. And if you're not bringing forth fruit, God's going to try to lift you up. He's going to send people with messages like this, trying to lift you up. Lift you up, right? And if you are bearing fruit, he's going to continue to wash you from guilt and things like this so you can bring forth more fruit. Isn't that good news?
Good news.
Good news. Praise God. I want to pray right now. If you're not born again, if you've never said yes to